I will cut straight to the point and start with oil. Now, in our industrial and also post-industrial societies, the societies have been to a large extent been defined by the usage of oil, and this has of course led to the much the well-reported repercussions that have materialized in climate change. It is actually a premium example of scientific research that started with a small pioneering group of researchers in the 1970s who made a connection between the global warming and the greenhouse effect. And slowly, with much academic debate, it was actually it has come to be virtually universally accepted by the scientific community by the early 2000s or so, only challenged for political reasons. Now you do not only burn oil and oil-based or fossil-based materials, fossil-based sources for energy. You use them also for materials. Plastics are a case in point, and most of the chemicals the raw chemicals in the chemical industry are actually oil-based. Now this brings me to bit of a a contradiction. My expertise is in plant-based materials, so how to use plants, and you can use them for biofuels, so for fuels, transportation fuels mainly, or materials. And now I'm not an expert in fuel industry or engineering, but I have been told that the potential of biofuels to replace the fossil-based constituents would be roughly 0.5% of the global energy consumption nowadays. So it is quite a meager bit of what we could do with biofuels. And in this realm, I think it would be more sensible to concentrate on the materials side of how to use plants. Now, if we start from the plant, we always start from the plant fiber. It is pictured there in the middle. Plant fibers are hollow tubes, some micrometers or tens of micrometers in width, millimeters in length in general. And utilization of plant fibers, of separating them from one another and making, for instance, paper or textiles, that has been utilized by men for centuries, even millennia. Now, where we have gained a lot of understanding recently is actually here in the ultrastructure, as how we call it, the plant fiber. So this is actually what I majored here in at Helsinki University of Technology when I did my master's here. So we have plant fiber in so-called nanoscale dimensions, and then we are looking at the interactions and the organization of the chemical components with respect to one another in the plant fibers. This is something that there's very high level expertise in Finland or in Scandinavia altogether, and there are very few places where this is taught at the university level, really. And I would like to highlight there are many components in plant cell walls, several at least, one could say. And what is the important bit here is called cellulose. Cellulose is a molecule made of sugar units. It is what we chemists call a polysaccharide, right? And it makes up few cellulose molecules together make these longitudinal threads of very narrow dimensions, which are called cellulose microfibrils. They are just, they are just 3 nanometers in width, and they consist of just 18 cellulose, individual cellulose molecules. And they give plant fibers the strength, the character it has. And nowadays it is feasible with modern technology to separate, isolate these microfibrils and even chop them to smaller pieces. And these entities are called nanocellulose. And the ways to isolate nanocellulose from plant fibers, they are engineering technologies that have emerged, or not emerged, but have matured only since I gained my PhD in 2005, within the matter of less than 2 decades. And many of these are still on the pilot stage, if even that. Now, why people want to do these really, really small sections of cellulose? It's the same reason as with all nanomaterials. They have different properties because of their size, right? The only thing that actually distinguishes nanomaterials from normal materials is the size. They are very small, and that means they have a lot of interface, a lot of surface area, right? This means that if you make a paper out of cellulose nanofibers instead of normal fibers, you get a film that can be 10 times stronger than paper because of the high surface area and the bonding points. And it is also, it can be transparent because of the small size below the wavelength of light of these nanofibers. You can also have highly controlled porosity when we make up macroscopic objects from this nanocellulose. Nanopapers depicted here is actually, it is a transparent film, and it is just placed on top of a paper. So you can't really see it. It's transparent, but it's very strong. And this, you could imagine, could already substitute a lot of fossil-based materials. There's one major issue with them. So this is water. Many of the products developed or built from nanocellulose, they actually have the same weakness as normal paper or cardboard. You place them in water, it does not dissolve in it, but it starts to swell, disintegrate slowly, loses its mechanical integrity, right? Now, this is different in plants. Plants here, they are fine by water, right? So they don't mind. They even use water. They don't use it just for photosynthesis and essential living functionalities. They also use it for materials properties. A good example here is the tree, that is actually much more flexible a construct than stiff logs that have been felled, and exactly the same trunks of the tree that have been dehydrated, that water has been removed, which are much stiffer materials than if you think about trees swaying in the wind. And this is a way how nature can actually utilize water, not just for the living functions, but also for materials properties, really. This might sound very simple, but how it does this, how the plants do this, it is related to the very fine structure of this wood fiber or plant fiber or the fiber cell wall. And this is, again, something where the knowledge has enormously grown within the past two decades, I would say, really. So here is a figure from 10, 20 years ago, And there's a figure from a couple of years ago. It's not my own research. It's from Paul Dupre's group in Cambridge, with whom I do collaborate. But they know exactly the positions of different components in the plant cell wall, and how water is related to these alignments and structures. And this is actually what gives plants their specific character. Now, then we can isolate these components and look at them individually, build experimental models, and expose them to controlled conditions like humidity in very simple setups. And these enable us to know how the water is incorporated within the structure of the individual components. Here is, for instance, we can use nanocellulose now. We know very well the structure, we know the dimensions. It is an age-old kind of technique to measure the water uptake of cellulosic fibers and systems. You can have a piece of paper or cotton or whatever, and then you expose it to certain relative humidities or liquid water, and you measure simply the weight difference, the water uptake. But this and this research has been done for 100 years more over that, but really to know the locations of the water molecules and how their structure may change from that of bulk water, and how they influence the structure of the cellulose components with each other. This is something that can be only achieved with this, for example, with these experimental models built from nanocellulose. Now, I will give you, to wrap everything up, I will give you four examples of research, my own research, we are actually using the water cellulose, or the understanding of the water interactions within cellulose, for functional applications. Some of them may be at a rudimentary level, but still they are genuine materials that we are building. So the first example is photosynthetic cell factories. Cell factories, they consist of photosynthetic cells that can be incorporated to a wet, water-soaked nanocellulose network and be immobilized there. They can be algal cells, for example, and they can be used there. They can be controlled there, to manufacture chemicals such as ethylene, depicted in here, which is normally from fossil-based sources. And normally cell factories are in large pools of water, but the control is much better in this immobilized matrix of nanocellulose, including the water, where we can also control the diffusion of the products, etc. Another very large line of research with nanocellulose, as with almost any material nowadays, is energy storage. These are only budding research from my side, but they can be nanocellulose, water-soaked nanocellulose membranes can be used as electrodes, alternative electrodes in, for instance, batteries or supercapacitors. And to know, again, the controlled porosity of these nanocellulose materials that which affect the ion transport of the material, thereby we can control the properties and the performance of the batteries in a very controlled manner. Third example is actually the oldest in my own line of research, is we can use cellulose fibers, so directly taken from plants or then somewhat processed, containing a little bit of water. And water is actually here a reagent. It's a chemical reagent which reacts when being made in contact with catalyst, which in this case is hydrochloric acid. And this is a research which I'm particularly proud of, because it emerged some 10 years ago with me just with pen and paper at the office, and I was thinking about the fundamentals of gas adsorption and the physical chemistry of acid dissociation, and it has now grown into a realm that where we have several projects on the issues. There are other groups globally working on this, and we are looking for business opportunities with the aid of, for instance, European Union and Business Finland funding. So it's a good example where fundamental research can lead you. And then the final example is biomineralization. So we can use a crystalline nanocellulose template as a substrate that enhances the crystallization of calcium phosphate, and these templates could potentially be used as bone healing matrices, as bioactive bone healing matrices, very different from just the titania plates that are used nowadays just to fix the fractured parts together. So all these examples are, I would say, what all technical universities stand for. So we make a starting point from fundamental research, and then one way or another translate it to something useful in engineering applications. And this is all the more important, of course, in the growing demand for the more sustainable world, as it is trendy to say nowadays. Now, of course, we know that climate change is not probably the most immediate threat to the society. Of course, in this so-called Western civilization, we are faced with the cruelty and arrogance of conspiracy theorists and aspiring dictators. And I would say the only way to answer this is by the same means as we approach scientific research, which is to pledge to the humility on the face of human understanding, and then acknowledge the affection between people. And this, I would say, is the only way forward. Thank you.